next speaker, and he's currently director of the Western Regional Climate Center, which is part of the Desert Research Institute in Reno, Nevada.
Just to give you a sense of area that I deal with in my daily job, it covers the 11 western states, plus Alaska and Hawaii, but I'm mostly going to be talking about this area right here. The West is the most urban region of the United States, defined as the number of people, the fraction of people living in cities, and I live in a state that's the most urban state, even though it's got a lot of empty space in it. The resource footprints for cities extend well beyond the city limits, and that's generally upstream and uphill. In the Old West, mining and agriculture really drove water law. Charles Wilkinson has written about this in his book, The Crossing the Next Meridian, as the five major laws is the lords of yesterday. We're still operating under those. But in the New West, the cities are really in the driver's seat. And the handwriting is pretty clear that agriculture will slowly give way to the cities. The planning and development time for major infrastructure is typically on the order of 2 to 4 decades. We'll be re-examining this climate issue probably once or twice a decade, and that means that the practical time frame that we should be looking at is probably in the order of 2020 to 2050. But we have to be aware from the outset that there might be potential irreversible commitments associated with the CO2 and other greenhouse gas issues that might have time frames of 100 or 200 or more years. You've already seen this graph that Sherry Rollin presented. If you were born in 1959, you're now breathing 21% more carbon dioxide with every breath than you were back then. And this is just to illustrate that the greenhouse gas contribution to the global climate forcing has been going up recently, but it's somewhat balanced by the aerosol contribution. There's two types of contributions here, coming from direct effects and indirect effects, and the occasional odd big volcano, which helps cool the planet too. This is just a picture taken a little bit earlier this year of looking straight down on China and Korea, and if you can't see the ground from a satellite, that's really polluted. And the fact that you can see it at all means that energy is being reflected back to space, so the Earth's system is losing this. This is a cooling influence. Also, this is heading toward the West Coast. Another thing that we see locally and regionally, this is flying from Reno over to San Francisco a couple years ago in the summertime, and here's the natural color of California right here. And as you fly a little bit further west, you see the unnatural color of California, which is dark green, absorbing energy differently. And finally, you get back to the other side, you get back to the natural color. But you also see one of the strangest things in the entire solar system. A couple hundred yards away from each other here is one river coming this direction, bringing water for agriculture, another river going that direction, bringing water from Northern California to its rightful place in Southern California. And then right next to it, you see I-5 bringing hordes of people up to visit Amy and keep her company up in Seattle, as they're all moving up in that direction. So what's going on in these 11 western states here? These are the projections from the climate models, a series of models with a series of emission scenarios. And what they're showing is that starting around 1970 or 80 or so, we should have started to depart from the baseline case, and by 2005 be up here about 1 degree C or so. This is north of Lake Tahoe. And this is the picture that Holly showed, but it's different because it has one data point more. We see this rise in temperature that started coincidentally about that time, about the last 30 years or so. It's been fairly steadily going up. That's 1934 that always stands out. And also you see a cluster of warm years here toward the end. There seems to be something different that's been going on in about the last dozen years or so. Precipitation models, or the precipitation projections, are quite different. They're all over the map. It's hard to find a clear consensus here, except that they tend to trend around zero. And this is the precipitation trends for the western states for the winter months. This is the important precipitation time of the year, is in the winter, October through March. And you don't really see much trend over this. This is back to 1895 for about 2,000 climate stations in the western U.S. But one thing you do see is a lot more variability. We had the driest winter and the wettest winter on record just in the last 25 or 30 years or so. Much more variability here than the previous 30 or 40 years or so. This is the entire year, the water year. And again, it shows a similar sort of thing. I don't see much trend here. It's going to be very hard to pick out a trend if one starts to occur because it's such a noisy system. Looking at the temperature trends in the United States, these are the trends over the past 30 years, and You can see that the areas in the redder colors are warming up about a degree Fahrenheit per decade or so. In the west and in the north, we don't see it, so we see a little bit in the northeast and hardly at all in the southeast. If anything, it's probably cooling off a little bit. It's more in the winter and the spring months, less in the summer, and even less in the fall. I pointed out earlier that recent period, warm period, this is the last 7 years, temperature departure from the past 105 years, and it shows that the western states and the northern states are warming up much more than the rest of the United States. If you put this in normalized terms, divide by standard deviations, it's more in the southwest. This warming issue, de facto, is really a western issue that's facing us in the United States. So it's on our doorstep. This is just to illustrate, this is the size of the grid boxes that are used in the climate models. They're about 2 degrees on a side. Well, they can go all the way from the coast to Lake Tahoe to back down to Reno, or down here maybe from Santa Barbara up to the top of Mount Whitney and back down to Death Valley, all encompassed by one number in these climate models. And we have a lot of structures, you can well see. Cities like Reno, here, this is the airport where the measurement is made. They get 7.5 inches, the same as Phoenix, Arizona, on an annual basis. And you only have to go about 5 or 10 miles away, you're up to about 70 inches. These people cannot live on 7.5 inches of precipitation falling out of the sky. All the western cities live off stuff like this, the big white area here. And we're very dependent on the mountains for sources of precipitation. So because of this, and because of some issues associated with climate in the mountains, there's a group of us that have formed this Consortium for Integrated Climate Research in Western Mountains. We're trying to push the issues of getting better climate research for the mountains, and I just wanted to point out one of the things that hasn't been mentioned a lot is just the issue of observation, where we work a lot. This is from Southwest Airlines, looking toward Mono Lake, and here's Mount Warren right here. Last summer, this is a picture taken by Connie Millar of Mount Warren from the north, and we put a climate station up on the top here. This is being funded by the State of California Energy Commission, and we're already starting to see, this is at 12,327 feet, and we're already starting to see plants that are growing here, so we want to be there when the climate moves up to meet it. And if you look directly west from this spot, you're looking at Mount Kness and the boundary of Yosemite National Park. You just go over the top, you're in the Tuolumne Drainage, which is this water supply for San Francisco. And you look the other way, you're looking down on Mono Lake, and off in the distance you can see the White Mountains. If you fly past the White Mountains, looking west, you can see, this is the same flight on Southwest, and you can see the White Mountains here and the High Sierra in the background. There's the Owens Valley with the Owens Valley Aqueduct. Right on the tippy top of White Mountain Summit, we put a climate station up there. It's at 14,246 feet. In fact, the climate station is the very highest thing on the whole mountain range. And it's reporting live on the internet every 10 minutes, the highest observing site in North America. And we're just trying to measure this so that we can be recording what the climate is doing as it varies. There's a lot of evidence for warming in the West. I don't want to go through it all in detail, but just to mention, we have measurements from thermometers, from the surface data network that's showing warming, from the upper air network, which is a separate network, from boreholes, or holes that are dug down into the ground in solid rock, and the upper part of them is warmer than the lower part. There's snowpack decreases in the spring months from the Snowtell network. More rain, less snow, as Holly was just showing, from the co-op network. Earlier snowmelt runoff from the stream gauge network. Earlier blooming of lilacs and honeysuckles from the phenology networks, mountain glacier recession and mass losses from the glaciologists, and the upward movement of plant and animal habitat zones from the plant and animalologists, and warmer rivers and lake temperatures. So there's a variety of evidence that's coming from independent types of information that seems to correspond. This is a complicated figure, but what it really shows is the vulnerability to a lot of the precipitation in the West when it falls. It's important that it falls as snow. And much of the precipitation that falls as snow is just barely below freezing. And if it warms up by just a little bit, by 2 or 3 degrees C, it takes it from being below freezing to being above freezing, and it switches from falling as snow to falling as rain. So where are those places and circumstances? That's what this is a graph of, put together by Mike Dettinger. And it shows that the Sierra and the Cascades are the two places in the West where just a small change in temperature means a big change in the type of precipitation that falls. This has lots of implications for the way water is managed and for how it stores itself, as well as for how we store it. The next most vulnerable places are the mountains of Idaho, eastern Oregon, and if you move up, the least vulnerable places among the mountains is probably the spine of the Rockies in Colorado and Wyoming, because they're high, and if it warms up, they're still below freezing, but they're not protected forever. The other thing is the green on this map, it's in the United States, the most vulnerable places are in the mountains, and the most vulnerable places in the mountains are right here along the West Coast. So we get a lot of questions of there's all this talk about is California warming up or not? So working with a recent UCI graduate, John Abatsu, who's a postdoc working for me, we've put together this thing we're calling a California Climate Tracker. It's on the web. You can just Google it and find it. And just to help answer questions like this, we update it every month. It goes back to 1895. And this is the state mean temperature from January through December, annual mean. And it has been warming up, especially of late. And if we look at the maximums, the daytime maximums, it's been warming up a little bit, but not so much. It's kind of been flat here for the past 60 or 70 years. But the minimums show quite a bit of warming, especially if you just compare these two, the max and the min and the max and the min. And just to show that this isn't a fluke for the state of California, if we move next door to Nevada, which has got quite a bit different climate, again, the mean temperatures, the max temperatures, and the min temperatures. This is something we're seeing throughout the West. The nighttime temperatures are increasing, especially lately, over the past years here. We've been setting a lot of records for nighttime minimum temperatures. Not really quite sure this is, but there is something to this. And we may not notice it because we're asleep, but nature is never asleep. And the snowpack and everything is, and plants and animals are all seeing this. Another thing about cities is that they can make their own climate. This is an infrared picture of Phoenix taken about 6 years ago in April at 10:51 in the evening. And the red area here, the city is warmer than its surroundings. And you can pick out this yellow area here, which is Sky Harbor Airport. And you might ask, where is the official climate station for Phoenix? It's right there in the airport. But cities, sometimes we want to subtract off the effect of cities so we can understand climate change, but other times we want to keep it in there because that's where people live and where the energy is being used. So it sort of depends on the purpose. Because this, if they heat up their own surroundings, they're going to have to take additional air conditioning just to deal with that. So I want to switch topics here and deal with drought. This is the drought monitor. It comes out every week. I've been working on it the entire time, supplying information to it. Since it came out in 1999, and here's 9 years worth, and the one thing you see is every year the West has been in almost perpetual drought, it seems like. It's on vacation, it kind of travels around, visits different parts of the West, but it's been a real regular visitor. It's made itself home here. As a consequence of this, there's been a lot of things that have been happening on the Colorado River system, and there was a panel put together to look at this issue that I was a part of. We just met here at this building to finish up here a few months ago. And this is the Colorado River here. This is the upper part and the lower part. And I just thought I'd show a picture of some nice western rivers that you're all used to. And here's what the Colorado looks like. It's a series of buckets and funnels and tubes and spigots and valves. There's at every single valve, there's a horde of water lawyers that's jealously guarding. Every single acre foot comes with its own lawyer in the system. And California itself has a very complicated distribution system. We're down here in the Southland, and there's three big straws. You saw pictures of a couple of them just a minute ago. There's this straw and the Owens Valley, and then there's a straw that runs over here. And here at Imperial Dam, the Colorado splits. This is the old channel, the historic channel, and then there's the other channel, which goes the other way. You can see the size of these things, a little bit different. This is the All-American Canal. And it ends up in a delta, and there's increasing demands for water for the delta. But the rest of it also goes to a delta as well, Delta Faucets here in San Diego and Los Angeles. But there is one difference between these two deltas. One of the deltas likes fluctuation. It goes up and down. The natural systems need this fluctuation, but this demand is pretty inflexible. It doesn't like to go a year without water. And that's what makes it different from the other type of delta. So this is the water year precipitation for the upper Colorado, taken from a system that we've set up to be able to pull this out. And here's the drought that we've been experiencing. A very low year here in 2002. We had one good year. We're down here last year. This year is going to drop down here again. The drought is going to continue with this poor water year. There was a drought in the 50s that Holly mentioned. And the difference is on the upper Colorado Basin that this new drought is about a degree and a half Fahrenheit warmer than the drought of the 50s. So that has lots of consequences all by itself, as she pointed out. Well, this has led to some low stream flows. Low stream flows mean that Lake Powell storage, which started at zero, went up full, dropped down to 33% a couple years ago. It's currently 49% full, or depending on your psychological persuasion, 51% empty. And it's 100 feet below full pool. It will go up about 6 feet more and then start to drop, and it's going to drop pretty well this year because it's not going to get much inflow. These are the projections of the climate models. Basically, they're showing not much change in precipitation. This is 19 different climate models all averaged together. Maybe 6 or 8% decrease down here, and maybe a 5 or 6 or 7% increase in the northern border. But not a lot of change in the western states on an annual basis that's being projected. There's a recent study that came out by Richard Seeger and company of these 19 climate models, basically showing a drying in these areas of the world. The subtropical belts expanding as the circulation patterns shift northward. They're claiming that the drought that we're seeing right now may be a precursor of that or an indicator of that. And the other thing is we really have to resolve these differences. This is a major issue that the field of climatology and hydrology have to work out. And there's this big lingering question. Is the current Southwest drought a once or twice a century drought, a run-of-the-mill, you know, once or twice a century drought, or is it a harbinger of things to come, a different type of drought that we have not observed before? We have to answer this question. But if you look at this, it has been drying out recently, but we've had a lot of wet years here in the Colorado River system in the past few years. So the jury, to me, is still out on this. So this is the year so far. It's been another dry year, especially along the south coast here. This is annual precipitation through March. It's the lowest on record. 2 years ago, we had the highest on record. There's this tremendous variability. This is the most variable precipitation climate in the United States, right here in Southern California. And we had another thing that's happened recently several times in the past decade. We went into March in not very good shape. We had a dry March and a warm March, and it really decimated the snowpack. We lost about 20 percentage points in a month when we expect to be gaining. And this has really hammered the Colorado River Basin. And this is a picture of Tioga Pass. It was taken on April 5th from the webcam that we have up there. And you can see bare pavement, where last year about 5 or 6 feet of snow at this spot. So this is a picture of Telescope Peak and Badwater in Death Valley taken earlier this year, showing not much snow down there. So I'll stop there.